Okay, so you probably know the basics of the King Arthur story, right?
Noble British king, myself, ushers in a golden age and gets his magical sword from...
An equally magical lady, myself, who lives in a lake. Arthur's guided to her by a...
Magician, who also, of course, provides guidance, peers through time, shapeshifts, easy stuff. But his...
Strongest and most gallant knight ends up causing a spot of trouble. Usually if the, extramarital kind.
But do you know how all this got started? Because the Arthur legend builds and changes with every writer, every generation. We trace these characters back to where they got their start, whether in history or in myth, or many times a little of both.
Here are the secret origins
of four Arthurian characters.
You know, from your childhood.
And we'll definitely know again in Cursed.
Nimue in Cursed is a fairly big departure from the traditional tale of Arthur.
I mean, not only is she the Wolfblood Witch.
That part wasn't in the 12th century poems.
But she also belongs to a persecuted magical minority, the Fae.
But it makes sense, because more than any other character, Nimue is never really the same. First, she doesn't even always have the same name. Sometimes she shows up as Vivian or Ninian. In fact, she's just one Lady of the Lake. It's more of a title that passes between characters, like, I don't know, the Duchess of York does. Even the villainous Morgan Le Fay is a Lady of the Lake in some stories. And she can be helpful to Arthur's cause or, supremely unhelpful. For instance, she typically does deliver Excalibur to Arthur from her watery abode, and she helps ferry his wounded body to the mystical Isle of Avalon for healing. But on the other hand, she's quite famous for apprenticing with Merlin, learning all his spells, and then, sometimes out of cruelty, sometimes because Merlin is a dirty old man, magically entombing him inside a tree or under a stone, ensuring his demise. While it's nice to think that there were magical female small business owners distributing weaponry from lakeside locations in the Middle Ages, the reality is that Nimue is almost certainly of entirely mythical origins. Back then, there were a whole lot of water spirits in this damp part of the world. One kind of Welsh water fairy, say this with us.
Gwarag.
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 The Gwrageth.
And...
The Gwrageth.
The Gwrageth Annwn were beautiful women known to live in submerged villages and towns beneath lakes, usually hidden by spells. So they're actually known as lake maidens. But there may also be a clue to Nimue's origins in her many names. The name Nimue itself resembles the Greek or Roman Mnemi, one of the muses or water nymphs who bestowed a sword on the hero Perseus, kind of like a certain once and future king. Some also may find similarity between Nimue's alter ego Vivian or Coviviana and Coventina, a Celtic water goddess whose followers paid tribute to her by throwing objects in bodies of water, particularly wells. It was usually coins, but weapons were deposited underwater across Britain. In Nimue's more modern interpretation in Cursed, she's a magical healer that gets labeled a devilish witch, and maybe it's hard to believe, but that does have a little precedent in history. In medieval Europe, village wise women would use white magic, aided by herbs, to heal wounds. But over time, authorities grew suspicious of anyone who claimed they had magical powers. They thought it was witchcraft, enabled by the devil. So the wise women, plus many who never had any connection to magic at all, were tried and sometimes executed. It's a pretty grim origin.
But based on a goddess, that I can work with.
My character in Cursed, a lovable, singing sellsword named Arthur, is just really trying to do the right thing.
Oh, God!
Okay, well, at least the legendary Arthur generally wanted to do the right thing. Over the centuries, he becomes sort of a superhero, the son of King Uther Pendragon, unaware of his birthright until, at a knightly tournament, he fulfills Merlin's prophecy and pulls a magical sword from a stone.
By the way, that's usually a separate sword from Excalibur that grants cooler powers. Confusing, I know.
After many adventures and noble deeds, now King Arthur sets up shop in Camelot and establishes the Round Table, like his version of the Avengers. The table is symbolic, preventing squabbling over rank between his knights, unlike what often happened in actual Europe. Of course, he dies a superhero's death, fighting off a takeover from his evil, illegitimate son Mordred, and sailing off into the sunset with the ladies of the lake.
Wait, he dies?
But scholars still seriously debate whether this noble character, whose modern incarnation first appears in Geoffrey of Monmouth's History of the Kings of Britain, was actually based off of a real king or not. There are several candidates, most of whom aren't really kings, but whatever, a tough fighter is close enough. The earliest lived in the later parts of the 2nd century, which is at least several centuries before Arthur supposedly ruled. His name was Lucius Artorius Castus, and the middle name is significant because it's rare to find Arthurs in Britain for a few centuries. Artorius was a Roman commander that led a Roman-British invasion into Brittany, which matches certain Arthurian tales. But most importantly, besides his name, he commanded a tribe of warriors from Central Asia called Sarmatians, who looked the part of the Knights of the Round Table. They even had dragons as their banners. And scholars have pointed out that the folktales of Sarmatia share some similarities to Arthurian legend. If you go into the 5th century, closer to when Arthur supposedly ruled, there's Riothamus. We don't know much about him personally. In fact, the name might be a title, meaning highest king. But we do know that, similar to Arthur in Geoffrey of Monmouth's tale, he was a British king that crossed into Gaul twice, was betrayed by a close advisor, and maybe passed through a town called Avalon before vanishing. There's also another Roman-British general, Ambrosius Aurelianus.
Remember this name.
And an Irish-Scottish warlord, Artur Mac Aidan. But maybe Arthur wasn't ever human. Some think the name Arthur, which coincidentally resembles the Welsh for bear and man, evolved from the stories of a Celtic bear god. But there are holes in that theory too, like bear cults weren't as trendy in England as they were on the continent. So after all that, who was the real Arthur?
Maybe he's just a charming guy with a fantastic singing voice. Has anyone researched that?
So, you might know that in Cursed.
The sullen, homicidal, weeping monk turns out to be none other than the famous Lancelot. It's a bit of a departure from the golden boy of legend, but even in the books, Lancelot does have a tendency to
wreck things.
Believe it or not, he was raised by our very own Lady of the Lake, who in some tales takes him in after his father, King Bran, dies. She hangs around and acts as a fairy godmother, spoiling him with magical items and curing the occasional bout of insanity he suffers. Sometimes he's even called Lancelot du Lac of the Lake. In his adulthood, he's usually depicted as the most skilled and chivalrous of Arthur's Round Table. Like in his first major appearance, he jumps into a speeding cart to save Guinevere, which was a much bigger deal than it sounds because in those days only criminals rode in carts. Lancelot's relationship with Guinevere, Arthur's wife, sort of comes to define him. Because the two can't resist their attraction towards each other, Camelot ends up falling and everybody dies.
Right.
Lancelot wasn't initially in the Arthur saga as imagined by Geoffrey of Monmouth. He doesn't show up until French poet Chrétien de Troyes writes about him about 40 years later. So he probably was a de Troyes creation, perhaps influenced by earlier medieval romances like Tristan and Isolde. That said, there are accounts of royal affairs. In 1314, too late for de Troyes, but not too late for other Arthur writers like Thomas Malory, scandal erupted in France when the daughters of the king accused the daughters-in-law of the king of having affairs in a Parisian tower with knights named Sir Walter and Sir Philip, respectively. Lancelot's a better name. But there are some who think Lancelot has a connection to the pagan gods, specifically an Irish god named Lu. If you strain Lu's full name through the colander of enough languages, it begins to resemble Lancelot. Appropriately enough, while Lancelot of legend never goes on a fae-killing rampage like the weeping monk does in Cursed, he does actually become a monk in many stories, spending his time praying and repenting after the fall of Camelot.
I too shall repent.
In Cursed, Merlin, wait, just 1 minute. I'm last? No, Merlin is actually in stories before anyone else here. Shouldn't this all be called, I don't know, the Merlin Saga? Merced?
Okay, but really, Merlin is probably the most famous wizard in all of literature. and his staying power in one form or another is remarkable. The earliest appearance of the Merlin figure was nearly 600 years before his modern makeover in Geoffrey of Monmouth's writings. In both Scottish and Welsh poems and legends dating back to the 6th century, a hairy wild man of the forest named either Lailikin or, wait for it, Merdin, foretold the future for travelers and saints who came to visit him. He predicted a lot, but one that has stuck with us is how he knew he'd die 3 deaths. And so he was pushed off a riverside cliff onto a stake, only to die later by drowning. It's overkill. But Lailikin slash Merdin may have some basis in truth, at least in part. The wild man was said to be the sole traumatized survivor of the Battle of Arth Deirid, which may have actually happened in the year 573 in northern Britain. There is actually a real town in Wales called Carmarthen, or Merlin's Fortress. It was indeed around when Merdin might have existed, but Merdin's name may have come from it rather than it coming from Merdin. Regardless, they're very proud of the association. Merlin's other potentially real forefather was one of the Roman-British commanders that's been tied to King Arthur II. On this front, there's solid evidence that Ambrosius Aurelianus was a real leader that lived in the 5th century, but some of his feats are embellished, shall we say. He was, for instance, allegedly immaculately concepted. Geoffrey of Monmouth took these two semi-fictional characters and reimagined them as Arthur's magic benefactor, even sometimes just swapping out Aurelianus's name in some tales. But Geoffrey was no fool. He knew that the name Merdin, which sounds like sh** in French, wouldn't cut it. Thus, the character became Merlin Ambrosius, and then just Merlin. Over the next few hundred years, Merlin's backstory grew and his powers multiplied. He became the son of the devil, who nevertheless did God's work. He could tell the future, shapeshift, and change the weather.
What? And that whole time I wasn't allowed to do any magic?
But as weird as this sounds, being a court magician wasn't totally out there in the 12th and 13th centuries when a lot of the Arthur saga was being developed. At the time, newly translated Greek and Arabic texts, you can think of them as magical instruction manuals, were trendy with the upper classes. It was believed that with elaborate rituals and incantations, you could read the future, speak with the dead, and make everything turn to gold. So this, Merlin's lab and cursed, might not be far off from the historical reality. In fact, with all the history in this show, you could now think of cursed as a period drama. Merlin is coming for you, the crown.
So the Arthur saga is more complex than your old books could make it seem. It's part history, it's part myth, it's part historical myth.
So you know where these characters have been, but now you'll find out where they go. Have fun. Watch Cursed.